Well, good evening, folks. It's Sunday evening, the 28th of June, and this is our first weekend wind down. As we're sitting, we're unable to gather together, but we thought it would be helpful at the end of a weekend just to spend some time reflecting on life and living and God's Word, and seeing the sufficiency of Scripture, even in terms of the issues that we're facing. And so this is the first episode of that. It's my privilege this evening to welcome John Rowland. John was an elder at the church up until about mid-March. And took the gap at the AGM to disappear into the dust, and then lockdown happened. So I bet he recognized you, my brother, when you arrived.
Yeah, glad to be here. Thank you very much for the invitation.
It's like the masked invader that I found at the church gate when I opened him up. You know, it's what is that old thing, Zorro, with the strip mask? You can pretend whoever we want to behind the scenes. But John, thanks for making time for us this evening. I know you've been through a bit of the mill, in a sense, even as a couple and as a family, over the last couple of months as well. It was just at the early part of lockdown when Roslyn went splat, and it's kind of changed life during lockdown, I think, for the Rowlands. Eh?
Absolutely, yes, for sure. Yes, she took a fall, and there was a compound fracture and dislocation of the ankle, and the surgeon who operated on her said it was one of the worst injuries he'd ever dealt with, and she was in hospital for and stepped down for added up to over 3 weeks.
Sure. So and where to next? I mean, as we were chatting, even just setting up, you said that she's now learning to walk again and physio and so forth. So.
Yeah, we're going to physio twice a week. She's the plaster cast is off, and she's using a moon boot, and with the aid of a walker, she can walk about 20 meters very slowly.
Okay. So the next step is what? Volleyball, touch rugby in the garden? I'm just I'm not sure.
Well, we'll get her ready for Comrades next year.
There we go. Because the Comrades is wedding. Hopefully we'll be past Corona at that stage as well.
Yeah.
Maybe we should just pick up on that, because that's an issue that is affecting all of us, and I think our lives in a very real way. So, I mean, you've been locked down, unable to, in a sense, be attending services, unable to do your normal Douglasdale Retirement Village ministry. How have you handle that spiritually? What's John done to stay fresh in terms of your own walk with the Lord through the season?
Well, in many ways, in my personal life, I carry on much as I've always done. I've always practiced a morning quiet time, and I have a system by which I read through the Bible about once every 2 years and spend time in prayer. So in that sense, my personal life has gone on as per usual.
Yeah.
But I have missed interacting with people by teaching a couple of Bible studies a week and a couple of services per month. I haven't had that to do. But otherwise, at a personal level, it's much the same as usual.
So, I mean, just in terms of your reading plan, where are you at?
Well, what I do is I work a couple of books of the Old Testament and then move to the New Testament. And I started roughly 2 years. I started the plan at the end of March and read through Genesis and Exodus. Then I jumped to Luke. And then back to Leviticus and Numbers. And then I'm nearly halfway through the book of Acts now.
Okay, great.
That's what I've done since, it was actually the 28th of March that I restarted my plan.
Nice. So any kind of big themes that have been emerging for you that the Lord's been teaching you?
Well, although I've quite clearly read through the Bible many times, I still get a thrill with something now and again jumping out at me as I read. I really enjoyed Luke's gospel, and could find one or two things jumping out, even from books like Leviticus.
Yeah. Yeah, it's always been said that Leviticus is almost foundational reading for Hebrews. If you understand what the Levitical code was, it unlocks Hebrews as a follow-up. So that might be a... even beyond that, I mean, just in terms of other reading, both Christian literature or whatever. What's on your shelf? What's on your nightstand?
I love biography. Just before lockdown, I wanted an authoritative biography on John Newton, which I read at the more at the beginning of lockdown. I'm also rereading the fourth volume of a set of books on church history called 2,000 Years of Christ's Power.
Is that Beale?
No. 2000. That's Nick Needham. Needham is church history, and just the other day I picked up and I'm rereading a biography of George Muller of Bristol, and I can really recommend to Christian friends and people read Christian biography and learn from the lives of famous Christians of the past, whether they be preachers or missionaries or whatever kind of work they were doing.
Yeah, I mean, Muller stands out as a great example of prayer, I think.
Absolutely.
And just in terms of faithfulness and a daily dependency on the Lord, which I think is certainly something that we can learn from. I think what also struck me with Muller is just the passion that he had for, was it five of his unsaved friends over many decades? And I think he just kind of kept praying and interceding for them, and some of them only came to faith long after Muller himself had actually died. So sometimes we don't see the results of our prayer now.
Well, that's why I need to reread. I read it probably 15 years ago, that particular it's an authorized biography, and it was first written in about 1898.
Okay.
Yeah, this is the 20th impression, I think.
That's a great example. So I think it's good exhortation to pick up biographies and actually just learn from the great men and women of the faith that have preceded us. So, but just talking about maybe preceding, I know you're an expert on church music and love. I'm pulling your leg, John.
Okay.
but I mean, in the absence of corporate worship on a Sunday, has there been any particular song or hymn that, in a sense, maybe you've gravitated to, even just dwelling on the lyrics, that has been a...
Well, you know,
help.
With the stress involved with Rosalind's accident, I must be very candid here. I'm not very much a music and singing person.
Well, that's why I was pulling your leg.
at all, but I would say my personal experience would be summed up in the famous hymn by Horatio Spafford, when peace like a river
it is well with my soul,
attends all my way, and then it is well with my soul. But you know, from Spafford, there's a lesson to learn. Although he could write such magnificent words in that hymn, and it truly is a magnificent hymn, he himself was way off beam doctrinally in a number of areas.
Okay, didn't know that.
And and he gradually got worse, and he left the Presbyterian church that he was going to, and started his own weird little cult, He didn't finish off his days really as a Christian at all, because the cult was really weird. It was quite something.
The
other day it came to me, and I'm going to read it. It's very, very short. It's a song or hymn from my childhood and youth at Sunday school. And I'll read it to you. God be in my head and in my understanding. God be in my eyes and in my looking. God be in my mouth and in my speaking. God be in my heart and in my thinking. God be at my end and at my departing. Is a wonderful little song, and I can say that's a wonderful prayer, but Spafford didn't live that out in his life for sure.
Yeah. Well, that was a favorite at St. Stithian's Chapel services, man. That should have been a blast from the past, not just from your childhood, but from teaching there as well. I remember it from there. So. Just picking up on Spafford, John, I mean, what do we do then as believers to safeguard against that? We've got the examples. Let's assume he's not a full apostate, but he's gone wayward in terms of doctrine and is off the rails. But just from your own experience as counsel, what are the correctives that we should be applying to ensure that we don't go down that road?
Besides frequent attendance at Christian meetings, personal reading of the Bible regularly, and also I think every Christian should build up within their own heart and mind a system of doctrine, an ordered way of putting the Christian faith and what we believe.
It's helpful. Thanks.
Yeah, that's. However, I doubt whether we could call Spafford a Christian at the end of his life at all. When you read the descriptions of it, but we should also. The Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians. At the end of 2 Corinthians, there says, "Examine yourself, test yourself, to see if you're in the faith. If indeed Christ is in you, so personal self-examination is against the word of God, is a Christian duty."
Yep. Yeah, and we've got the objective criteria to put ourselves through, and in a sense. If you're listening to this, I mean, that's where I was this morning, even in the Beatitudes, of just saying, is there righteousness in our lives that actually authenticates the faith that we have? You know, if there's no fruit, if there's no holiness.
Absolutely.
And that's the phrase that I've used a number of times, that our present sanctification proves our past justification and assures us of future glorification. I think that's the issue. Is there evidence now to, in a sense, validate that?
And of course, 1 John is really is a little letter that is designed just for that. John writes in chapter 5, he says, "I write these things to you that you may know that you have eternal life."
Indeed. Well, that was the whole basis. I mean, January, February, I think I preached through that and just had a look at those various criteria. So it might be a blast from the past, you know, pre-lockdown retro preaching. John, even beyond spiritual life per se and faith, just engaging with people who are struggling, maybe weaker in the faith, maybe younger believers, maybe even older believers who are on their own. They can't get a service, they're missing Bible study, they're missing contact, they're missing human conversation, human touch, just the sharpening from other believers. What practical things, even during this season, in the absence of normality, would be helpful to just keep somebody motivated? I mean, we've got that passage in Hebrews about the drooping hands and the weak knees. How do we prop people up and keep them motivated?
Well, we're living in a wonderful age with modern technology where we can have face-to-face conversations through WhatsApp.
Yep.
I chat with my daughter who lives in England, in Gloucester, regularly, face-to-face, and we could phone up, if we got struggles, we could phone up a person, person who we recognize is knowledgeable and mature in the faith, and ask them, ask questions on how to handle the situation. And as I say, you can even look at each other.
Yeah.
And by that method, we can't actually touch each other and shake hands and hug and all those things, but we can actually speak to each other face to face. And I had an interesting incident the other day where I accidentally phoned an ex lady, Ida Efinda, who emigrated to America.
Yeah.
I accidentally phoned her up at 4 o'clock in the morning, her time, and she had written a WhatsApp to me and asked me, what's going on in the world? So, and I gave her my personal views and explanation, and from what she said, she was actually helped and blessed by that explanation.
Oh, I'm glad. I know you're still actually following our services and so forth. So, my sister, if you're listening, we're speaking about you behind your back, but even from the States. But yeah, John, let's run with that. I mean, what's happening in the world? Because people are battling with these issues. There's conspiracy theories and weird and wonderful thoughts and interpretations and some weird and wacky eschatologies that and prophetic ministries, and people are trying to fit all of this COVID stuff into some apocalyptic grid and making it fit and so forth. I mean, what's happening? Where are we?
Well, I think that people go with all of those kind of ideas for two basic reasons. The first one is a lack of knowledge of history. For example, in the mid 1300s, there was what was called the Black Death, bubonic plague, that literally wiped out a third of the population all the way across from Asia and into Europe and to Britain.
Yeah.
And then if you go to the 1918 flu epidemic, now in the First World War, about 15 million people or men were killed in the trenches. But the flu epidemic, which was across the world, Australia, it hit South Africa and Europe as well, and the USA, it was all the way across the world. The historians estimate between 30 and 50 million people.
That's massive. Huh?
In 6 months. The First World War was 4 years, 15 million, and that flu epidemic, somewhere between 30 and 50 million in 6 months. Now, I'm sure there would have been Christians in those days who were saying, is this the end of the world? 102 years later, we're still here.
And if the Lord tarries for another 102 years, another pandemic.
And we cannot work out these things. I'd like to remind people of Revelation chapter 1 and verse 7. Is it? I've got the wrong one. Anyway, it's where the Lord says, it's in Revelation chapter 1, I can't pick it up now, but where the Lord says to his disciples, it's not for you to know the times and the seasons that the Father has in his authoritative plan for the future.
Yeah.
We cannot pin down when Christ will come again.
Indeed.
Yeah. In fact, if anyone's saying Christ will come again then or then or then, they're out of line. They're speaking against the words of Christ himself.
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, I think part of the musings of people during this period is Some would actually say that it's a sign of God's judgment against the world, that COVID, God is unleashing the virus.
Yeah.
I don't know, how do we push back against that?
There's the second reason. First of all, history, we're still here. But also the big picture of the Bible. If you read the Old Testament, especially all the prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, whole sections of those prophets, it says that God is going to judge Israel and the nations around with wars, with famines, with plagues of locusts, mm-hmm. and plagues of sickness and so on. And then to have a big picture, what I call a big picture of what the book of Revelation is doing, especially the middle section of that book, where it talks about God is between the first and the second comings of Christ is going to pour out all kinds of troubles on the world.
Yeah.
Plagues, famines, economic deprivation, and all of this kind of thing. So I'm giving you my perspective here, but I would say that the COVID-19 is actually one of those judgments of God. Mm. Yeah, it's only a general picture of judgments that will happen. And of course, people might well ask, judgment for what? Well, let's face it, we live in a world that has substantially rejected the Lord Jesus Christ.
Sure.
And so the judgment, whatever part of the world it is an unbelieving world.
Sure.
For the most part.
Yeah.
And therefore, in general, we get these judgments coming through the history from when Christ first came until he comes again in glory.
But I mean, there should be even a bigger picture than that, is that we just live in a fallen, broken Genesis 3 world. I mean, all creation is groaning. It's been subjected to fertility under the hand of God. I mean, there's big picture issues at play even there.
Yeah, cited big picture. But, you know, as Christians, we shouldn't be anxious about these things. First of all, if we have personal economic problems, because you go to the Sermon on the Mount, to the section on, you know, look at the lilies of the field and the birds of the air, and you know, do not worry about these things that the Lord Jesus
indeed
has taught us,
and
that your heavenly Father will take care of you. But then if we do get sick with the coronavirus, do we really believe that if we pass from this world, we're going to heaven into the presence of Christ?
Sure.
And it's something not to be afraid of, but to look forward to.
Amen.
Is what I would say.
I thought you were going to sneak a little pre-mid-tribulation rapture in there as well, but we won't go down that road. But,
no.
But John, just picking up on that, I mean, well, what you just said now alludes back in a sense to where I was even with this morning on the Sermon on the Mount, with the reward in heaven, the long view being a help for us even in present affliction.
Mm-hmm.
Would you say that people on the whole, and I'm talking believers, and just don't have a good biblical theology, understanding the sweep of God's meta-narrative, in a sense, from the fall through to the final redemption. And then therefore we're not making sense of our own realities because we don't have a big overall storyline?
I think so. I think that's very much needed. One of the problems is that I think we need a reasonably small book written, given that. Beale's book on a New Testament biblical theology is 1,000 pages. Yeah. Now, not many of us are going to...
Some lightweight bedtime reading.
not many of us are going to read that. I just hope that Gregory Beale actually writes a sort of 200 to 300 page version.
Condensed version.
Condensed version of that.
Reader's Digest.
Yeah, well, not quite as bad as that.
Yeah. No, it's something that's been growing, and in a sense, my own preaching has been shaped by that over the last while as well, is to try and make sense of passages in in big story and to help people look back and forward. Mm-hmm. I think our worldview is deficient in terms of just making sense of where we're at if we don't have that big picture.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Just one other thing, maybe, while we've got you kind of in the lounge this evening drinking tea at the end of the weekend, at a pastoral level, just interacting with people kind of just pre-lockdown and even during lockdown over Zoom and phone calls and emails and so forth. I mean, I'd imagine it's broader than the Rainbow Baptist Church if we're realistic, but folks struggling with guilt. Just where they're at in terms of things done, things said, looking back sometimes over years, sometimes over many decades, you know, when I was a young person, ... And it ranges from just patterns of lifestyle through to immorality, through to a whole variety of different issues, and surfacing with the, I'm not sure that I'm worthy enough, I'm not sure that God loves me, I'm not sure whether I'm doing enough. My theory is that it in some ways goes to a deficient view of justification, but I don't know, any thoughts on that? How do we engage, how do we help people know that they are accepted and forgiven and in a right standing with God?
Well, I would agree with you. It's a weak view of justification and the cross. Christ has taken upon himself, he went through physical and psychological and emotional agonies on the cross, but he also suffered the wrath of God against the sin of his people. And if we are looking to Christ, that's what we must do. Do you know, I remember, this was 12 years ago now, I'm not a person, at least I don't think, suffers much at all from depression, but I was walking to work one day, and about halfway, a dark cloud of depression just descended upon me.
Sure.
And Paul warns us about that in Ephesians 6, that the fiery darts of the evil one came into my mind. But what I did, and this is something I learned from the sermons of Martin Lloyd-Jones, is I preached to myself. And I just preached to myself about, I have Christ's righteousness put to my account. Yep. That's settled. Christ has died for me, and all of my sins have been wiped away, and I'm on the road to heaven. And that dark cloud of depression lifted in a space of minutes, simply by reminding myself of basic doctrines.
Well, I think we see the psalmist doing that. Is it David in Psalm 42 and 43, I think, often says, why are you cast down on my soul? And so my spirit disquieted within me, yet will I. And he actually, in a sense, does exactly that.
Yeah.
In the midst of his own anxiety, he preaches truth to himself.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. Well, that's where I got it from Martin Lloyd-Jones' Spiritual Depression, where he actually preaches a whole series of sermons on why are you cast down, O my soul?
Okay.
I'm pretty sure that's where it came from. And that illustrates the point of the usefulness of reading good Christian literature.
Yeah.
I mean, I had read that probably 25 years before. And it just came to me, and that's what I did in order to deal with that particular problem.
A great strategy. But that again implies that we know truth, that we're getting fed well. I mean, it's if you've got no fuel in the tank,
amen.
You haven't got the reserves to actually draw from. Which loops back to where we started about just the need to be fresh and diligent in terms of our walk with the Lord. So, well, thank you. Well, thanks for your time, my brother. I think you haven't drank much of your tea. It's getting cold there. Johnny, just as we kind of wrap up this evening, any parting thoughts or comments that you want to just throw at the church from a distance? We can't see each other face to face, so take the gap.
It's self-discipline. You know, we have in the modern world a great gift that hasn't always been around. We're able to read.
Sure.
So we can read our Bibles. We have Bibles relatively cheap, that are relatively cheap. And we can just spend some of our money that's spare on good books. And if we're not sure what are good books and where to buy them, they could speak to you or me, and a number of other people in the church, to get and read biographies, read even if they're thin books, simple books on basic doctrine, and get a system of doctrine tucked away in your heart and mind.
You don't even have to come to me and steal off my shelf, and your sins will find you out. But I mean, there's some really good volumes available for free in terms of just downloads. I mean, a number of Piper's books, and even his short biographies, those 30, 40 page ones on Fuller and Luther and Calvin and so forth, are just really, they're freely accessible and really user friendly.
I come from the book age, not from the electronic age.
I'm encouraging. You find them online. Don't steal Gavin's. I'm getting gaps on my shelf where I'm like, there used to be one there. Well, my brother, thank you. Thanks for the time and coming in, and I appreciate that. And just pray that the Lord's hand would still be.
I appreciate being asked to come in. So
we'll give you and Rosalind the grace that you need even for the way ahead, and just to. Don't know if people coughing and sneezing on you, you should be fine. You know? Well, John, can I ask you to maybe just pray for us as a church moving forward? We'll just wrap up our time together and drink the dregs of what's left in our cups. Pray for us.
Heavenly Father, we bow before you to praise and thank you for modern media, whereby we can make this kind of presentation to our own church, and maybe many more people who will watch or listen to what we have been talking about. We pray that what we have spoken about will be helpful to people, and that your Spirit would take what we have said and write it into people's hearts, that they may, if they're downcast, they may be lifted up and encouraged. And if they are somewhat lacking in knowledge, that they have been built up a little bit more in knowledge by having this very informal conversation. And so we pray that your Spirit would take hold of our people as they engage with the sermons and devotionals, and as they maybe take up some of the advice that we have given here in this winter evening. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Well, John, thank you, my brother. Thanks for leading us in prayer, and thanks for your time this evening. In fact, thanks for making time to hook up and join us for Weekend Wind Down. Again, please give us some feedback in terms of how you found this. We really want it to be a benefit to you, whether you're watching it on a Sunday evening or during the course of the week. And we continue to pray that the Lord would continue to grow us all in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. Again, John, thanks for your time. Thanks for coming in. I see you drank some of your tea, which is a good thing. I hope that was enjoyable. But folks, for the rest of you, just have a good week and a God-sustained week. And keep faithful Keep in the word. Again, keep heeding, I think, some of the exhortations that we heard together this evening.